Welcome to Philosophy. This is the introductory lecture where I'll try to answer some of the most important questions about this course for beginners. First, I plan to talk about why learning philosophy is useful for you. Second, I want to give you some information by answering the question of what philosophy is. Third, I'll tell you how learning will be organized in the framework of this course. This is our plan for today. Shall we start? Well, you are not students of the philosophy department, but your curriculum contains two or three philosophical courses. So I want to explain why philosophy is in your curriculum. That is, why learning philosophy is useful for you. From my course, you will get some basic knowledge about philosophical terms, philosophical ways of thinking, and the main persons and stages in the development of philosophy. Also, you'll get other important benefits of learning this course. Let's take a closer look at them now. At our university, an introductory course to philosophy has four functions. The function of meta-theory, the function of critical thinking development, the function of strengthening students' argumentative skills, and the function of providing students with the awareness of the philosophical foundations of responsibility. As for the meta-theoretical function, this course will provide you with the tools of intellectual work with such notions as reality, cause, and truth. These notions are philosophical and, at the same time, they are fundamental to every area of knowledge. By analyzing them, you'll come to understand the real nature and deep content of the important notions of your professional disciplines. This intellectual work will help you understand your professional subjects better. To fulfill the function of critical thinking development, this course will help you to practice applying reliable patterns of reasoning, to avoid stereotypes, and to provide your own intellectual autonomy. If it doesn't seem enough for you, our course will give you knowledge of how to improve your argumentative skills. It will provide you with exciting examples of strong arguments from the history of philosophy. You'll get various assignments to practice written and oral argumentation. And the course will help you to understand how to achieve best results in such task fulfillment. Certainly, you'll have better command of argumentative techniques at the end of this course than you have at the beginning. So, in the 4th month, feel free to debate with anybody. You'll know how to overcome them. Also, in the framework of this course, we will talk about responsibility and the philosophical means to understanding for understanding the content and nature of such values as good, justice, and freedom. You will have the opportunity to tackle not only eternal moral issues, but also those specific challenges generated by the 21st century. Well, this course will give you information about some fundamental concepts. It will improve your critical thinking and argumentative skills, and will give you an understanding of moral challenges. Of course, such skills and pieces of knowledge are important for all students who are getting education at university level. That's why all the students at our university have a philosophy course in their curriculum. Okay, now I want to proceed to the second part of the lecture and talk about what philosophy is. This issue is really not that simple. Maybe you know that very different people do philosophy. For example, Judith Butler, Jürgen Habermas, Martha Nussbaum, and David Chalmers are some of the famous contemporary authors who live in our time. While prominent thinkers Plato and Aristotle lived more than 2,000 years ago, Averroes was a Muslim thinker from Cordoba, Confucius lived in China. Herbert Marshall McLuhan was a Canadian. Grigory Skvoroda was born in Ukraine. And Simone de Beauvoir lived in France. Marcus Aurelius was an emperor, whereas Epictetus was a slave. Thomas Aquinas was canonized by the Catholic Church, and Daniel Dennett is an atheist. Obviously, these thinkers are unique and they develop very different ideas, but they have something in common. What can unite all these different people? Every one of them does the same activity. All of them philosophize. What kind of activity is this? I want to start answering this question with the words of the former president of the American Philosophical Association, Robert Oddy, who defines philosophy as the systematic and critical study of ideas and issues, a reasoned pursuit of fundamental truths, a quest for a comprehensive understanding of the world, a study of principles of conduct, and much more. Philosophy is an activity of ordering our ideas about the most general and fundamental features of the world and our place in it. In the framework of philosophy, we challenge these ideas, check their soundness, make them deeper, develop them, and turn these ideas into a system. Some philosophers use the German term Weltanschauung, which means worldview, to describe the specifics of philosophy. They say that philosophical worldview differs from the religious, mythological, or scientific ones. Philosophy is much more critical than religion and mythology. At the same time, philosophy deals with more general questions than empirical science. Philosophy is concerned with really perplexing questions, such as what is the nature of reality, what is the nature of knowledge, and how should I live? These are perennial, big questions. You are philosophizing when you are trying to answer questions about general, fundamental aspects of the world and our place in it. And you are doing this critically. I want to clarify the specifics of philosophy by describing its subfields, subjects. If you understand of building blocks of philosophy, you'll be closer to understanding philosophy as a whole. Let's take epistemology. This is a part of philosophy which seeks to understand the nature and scope of knowledge. It deals with the questions, how do we justify our claims and what is knowledge? The aim of metaphysics, which is another part, is to gain insight into questions about being, reality, space and time. What is real? What is the case? What exists? These are the questions of metaphysics. Another issue of metaphysics is causation. Understanding causation is important for explanation. We can explain B by saying that A happens and A causes B. Also, understanding causation is important for predictions and actions. Beginners often confuse metaphysics and epistemology because they confuse what is the case and what we know to be the case. However, the world is one thing and your beliefs about the world are another. Of course, a significant difference between metaphysics and epistemology exists. Another philosophical subfield, logic, tries to elaborate the most effective means for rigorous and reasonable thinking. Logic contains a toolbox for a philosopher who wants to think rationally and consistently. Logic is how we do philosophy. The next subfield of philosophy, ethics, concerns standards of right and wrong conduct. It is a critical reflection on the values by which we live. For example, on such values as good, justice, and freedom. The history of philosophy, yet another subfield, gives a philosophical and historical interpretation of the development of philosophical ideas. It is not only a chronology of events in the area of philosophy, but also a philosophical interpretation of their development. Well, these are only some philosophical disciplines out of plenty of them. It's possible to do philosophy about every academic subject. There is a philosophy of chemistry, the philosophy of biology, the philosophy of mathematics, the philosophy of physics, the philosophy of psychology, the philosophy of philology, and so on. Understanding the distinction between doing some academic subject and doing philosophy about that subject is important. Let's take a chemist and a philosopher of chemistry as an example. While the first one focuses on dealing with formulas and solutions, doing measurements, creating a theory and collecting data to confirm it, the other considers what kind of data is needed to confirm or refute a theory, or what sort of theory could explain the data better. Dave Ward from the University of Edinburgh explains this peculiarity of philosophical approach using the following words. When we do philosophy, we step back and work out the right way to think about something. No matter what subject matter we are investigating or how we are investigating it, we can always step back, try to identify the presuppositions that inform our investigation, and think about whether they are the best ones. Thus, philosophy is a reasoned pursuit of fundamental truths, and we can apply it to different areas. Well, when did it all begin? Historians date the origin of philosophy to about 600 years BCE. The first philosophers of the West world were ancient Greek thinkers Thales, Anaximander, Anaximenes, Pythagoras, Heraclitus, and others. The first who used the term philosophy and who called himself a philosopher was Pythagoras. He coined the term philosophia from the words love and wise. Pythagoras said that no man is wise but God alone. However, a man can love wisdom, and that is to be a philosopher. When does loving somebody mean? What does loving somebody mean? It means to strive to become worthy of the object of their love. Philosophers strive to become worthy of wisdom. For this aim, philosophers think a lot about thinking, trying to elaborate perfect instruments for deep and truthful reasoning and understanding. Many philosophers also consider that a person who wants to be a true philosopher has to strive improvement in the area of moral issues. So, philosophy was created as the pursuit of wisdom. Also, I want to underline the dialogical nature of philosophy. There are different philosophical schools. Each philosopher has their own understanding of some philosophical questions. When a man philosophizes, he argues his own philosophical position, considering the position of other thinkers. A philosopher should give pieces of evidence for his own views and construct uncontroversial chains of reasoning. A philosopher has to be ready to prove his own claims. It is important for a philosopher to think well, to give a valid and sound arguments. I believe I need to explain this bit of philosophical jargon. What is a valid argument? Actually, an argument has such elements as conclusion and premises. We infer our conclusion from our premises. Premises must contain evidence for our conclusion. In the following classical example, we see three statements. The first and second are premises, and the last one is a conclusion. All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. If the premises are true and the structure of reason is correct, then the conclusion must be true. You can see it from this example. We can say that such argument is valid because the truth of the conclusion follows from the truth of the premises. So, proficiency in providing a valid and sound argument is an important part of the philosophical activity. During the lessons of our course, you will practice producing a valid argument, and I will assist you in doing it in a logically consistent, rational, and rigorous way. Well, it's time to proceed to the third part of this lecture. I'm going to tell you how your learning will be organized in the framework of this course. To start with, I want to emphasize that the aim of my course is to give you not only knowledge, but also skills in the area of philosophy. The mastery of a philosophical lexicon and knowledge of the main names and theories from the history of philosophy are not the only benefits of students of my course. I believe that students who study philosophy should gain philosophical skills as well. You are engaged in a sort of intellectual activity called philosophy. German philosopher Martin Heidegger thought that solving the task of understanding the nature of philosophy is impossible without immersion into philosophy or without philosophizing. He writes, "When we ask what is philosophy, then we are speaking about philosophy. By asking this way, we are obviously taking a stand above and therefore outside of philosophy. But the aim of our question is to enter into philosophy, to tear in it, to philosophize. The path of our discussion must therefore not only have a clear direction, but this direction must at the same time give us the guarantee that we are moving within philosophy and not outside of it and around it." Well, considering this, I'll offer you to try philosophizing in the framework of our course. Certainly, you'll get all the assistance you need. Some say that learning to philosophize is impossible. For instance, the 19th century English poet Samuel Coleridge said that you need the philosophical organ to do that. He considered that many of us lack this organ, and without it, a person is not able to philosophize. On the contrary, I believe that it is possible to learn philosophizing. It is not because anatomists have found some additional organs in the bodies of dead philosophers and it is possible to transplant them. Sorry to disappoint, but philosophers are as human-like as any other people. The point is that the analysis of philosophizing shows that this philosophizing has different levels. I want to mention the article published in 2011 by John Rudisill, a US professor of philosophy from the College of Worcester. This paper triggered extensive discussion of the possibilities and tasks of teaching philosophy among philosophy instructors. In his so-called minimal conception of doing philosophy, Rudisill convincingly showed that philosophizing has four levels, and that it is possible to teach doing philosophy. Well, These four levels are interpretation and analysis, critical assessment of arguments, ideas, and presuppositions, fluent application of philosophical concepts, distinction, and methods to address a philosophical problem, and creative development of novel approaches to puzzling issues. I know that a majority of you won't have big problems when learning techniques of the first and second levels of philosophizing. I mean the philosophical techniques of interpretation, analysis, and critical assessment of arguments and ideas. I have taught philosophy courses for 15 years and know that it is absolutely possible for students. However, I also know that only few students will be able to obtain fluent skills in the last two levels of philosophizing. I mean the level of application of philosophical concepts and methods to address a philosophical problem, and the creative development of novel approaches to puzzling issues. But philosophizing happens not only on its highest levels. It is entirely possible to do philosophy in the sphere of interpretation and critical assessment of ideas. I intend to help you with learning all four levels of philosophizing, but you need to know that you are responsible for your own progress. Different students will show different results in this learning. However, all of you will master some level of doing philosophy, and to do this, you do not need to have a special Coleridge's organ. Let me give you details about our learning. What will we do to improve your skills in interpretation and analysis? We will study Bertrand Russell and Ludwig Wittgenstein's techniques of philosophical analysis and Hans-Georg Gadamer's hermeneutics for interpretation. These are excellent techniques to advance in this level of philosophizing. Of course, we will read texts and discuss different problems for practical training of your skills in interpretation and analysis. As for the development of your skills in critical assessment, I will teach you to use Aristotle, Descartes, Hume's, and other philosophers' efficient techniques of critical assessment for different types of arguments, ideas, and presuppositions. I will definitely help you to gain practical experience in applying these techniques. One good way to do it is to write argumentative and critical papers, and you will have such writing assignments. Let me remind you that on the webpage of our course, you will find all necessary information on how to write philosophical papers and the list of topics for them. In the framework of our course, you will also have other ways to improve your skills in critical thinking. For example, at seminars, I will encourage you to comment on philosophical texts, speak about the weaknesses and strengths of an author's position, and elaborate your own interpretation of the author's source material. Naturally, I intend to offer you not to avoid controversial issues in discussion. I will foster your critical thinking through the exploration of such debatable issues as equality, justice, freedom, and so on. The level of fluent application of philosophical concepts, distinctions, and methods to address a philosophical problem is a more difficult task than the previous ones. Succeeding in teaching the application of, for example, Kant's concepts from his critique of pure reason is only possible for students who are well equipped with high level of abstract thinking. Of course, all students have some ability to think about principles and ideas that are not physically present. But not every student can demonstrate high results in this activity. Philosophy is an activity as an activity demands the strong performance of abstract thinking. My pedagogical experience informs me that there aren't any problems for students to apply the philosophical concepts of Diogenes, the Cynic, or Aristippus of Cyrene about the good life. However, sophisticated concepts like Descartes' ideas or Kant's transcendental idealism are very difficult to apply for many students. What will I do to foster your fluent application of philosophical concepts and methods to address a philosophical problem? First of all, I want to give you a wide range of philosophical concepts and methods. I am sure that each of you will find the ones that will catch your interest. I can give you individual assignments to improve your fluency in the concepts and methods which you find interesting. As you might know, I have contact hours when you are able to get personal consultation from me about every question that refers to our course. Feel free to ask me such questions. Particularly, I can help you to find philosophical theories which will be interesting for you personally. As soon as you find such a theory, you will be more motivated to study it deeply and apply it actively. Now, how will you practice the application of philosophical concepts and methods to address a philosophical problem? You will do it at seminars and in written and oral assignments. Well, the last and the highest level of philosophizing, according to Rudisill's scheme, is creatively developing and pursuing through the means of effective written and oral communication a novel approach to any of a certain broad class of puzzling issues. During my course, you will have some types of learning activities which will stimulate your creative skills in the area of philosophy. I will offer you thought experiments, brainstorms, group discussions of philosophical texts, and the possibility to write your own project. However, even though I can show you some philosophical techniques for developing novel approaches, I cannot teach you to want such development. I am going to remind you of Aristotle's famous idea about the role of wondering is in philosophizing. For from wonder man, both now and at the first began to philosophize, having felt astonishment originally at the things which were more obvious, indeed amongst those that were doubtful. Then by degrees, in this way, having advances onwards and in progress of time, having started difficulties about more important subjects. If students do not wonder, they cannot execute the level of philosophizing needed to develop novel approaches. I believe that some of you have the ability to feel astonishment at the things which are more obvious. This feature enables you to be effective at this level of philosophizing. To sum up, I want to say that practical activities of my course will help each of you to successfully get basic knowledge of the main philosophical terms and approaches. Also, the majority of you will succeed in learning philosophical techniques of effective interpretation, analysis, and critical assessment. Students who have an extended ability of abstract thinking, a high motivation to achieve intellectual autonomy, and a capability to feel philosophical astonishment will be able to achieve high levels of philosophizing. Well, I hope this brief introduction to philosophy has given you some information about what philosophy is, why learning philosophy will be useful for you, and how learning philosophy will be organized in the framework of this course. I want to finish by repeating the key points of this lecture. There are four reasons why this course will be useful for you. First, it will provide you with the tools of intellectual work with such philosophical notions as reality, cause, and truth, which are fundamental to every area of knowledge. Second, attending a philosophy course is a powerful tool to improve your critical thinking skills. It will help you to apply reliable patterns of reasoning, avoid stereotypes, and practice intellectual autonomy. Third, this course will strengthen your argumentative skills. You will have good command of argumentative techniques. Finally, in the framework of this course, you will have the opportunities to tackle moral issues, both eternal issues and specific ones that are generated by our time. As for the question of what philosophy is, I have given you some definitions of philosophy and ideas about its peculiarities. For example, philosophy is a systematic and critical study of ideas and issues, reasoned pursuit of fundamental truths, a quest for a comprehensive understanding of the world, a study of principles of conduct. Well, I have told you about the main subfields of philosophy: epistemology, metaphysics, logic, and ethics, and its history. As for the learning activities during this course, attending lectures will give you a systematic picture of philosophy and its most important elements. You will read philosophical texts and discuss different problems for obtaining skills in philosophical analysis and interpretation. You will write argumentative and critical papers. At seminars, I will encourage you to comment on philosophical texts, to speak about the weaknesses and strengths of an author's position. We will discuss controversial issues. All these activities are necessary to develop your skills in critical thinking. You will get information about a wide range of philosophical concepts. I will give you individual assignments to improve your fluency in concepts which are personally interesting for you. At seminars and in written and oral assignments, you will train your possibilities to apply philosophical concepts and methods to address philosophical problems. Moreover, you will have some types of learning activities which stimulate your creative skills in the area of philosophy. I will offer you thought experiments, brainstorms, group discussions of philosophical texts, and the possibility to write your own project. It will help you to be creative in philosophical issues. Well, my course will make you think a lot, discuss a lot, and read a lot. I can't promise you that it will be easy, but I am sure that this philosophy course will be useful and truly interesting for you.